India, where we have brought Sishu, Tarun and Kishore. Today, 10 crore entrepreneurs are funded out of Mudra, out of which 76% are women entrepreneurs and 50% are Dalit entrepreneurs. 10 lakh rupees the overall limit, 50,000 rupees under Shishu, under Kishore it is 50,000 to 5 lakh, under Tarun it is about 10 lakh. This limit is without any security, without any collateral. You can go to the bank, get it through like this. 10 crore entrepreneurs has been funded out about 4 lakh 60,000 crores are funded to this entrepreneurs. I think this kind of measures has to be brought in. The limits has to be doubled. Otherwise, the private sector cannot be breeded in India. This is my point. And I introduce the panelist, co-panelist. We have Sri A. Nyanashekaran, Control of Communication Accounts, DOT, Karnataka Circle. Sri A. Nyanashekaran, born on 2nd June 1960 in the town of Trichy, Tamil Nadu, completed his graduation in 1982 from Madras University, and post-graduation in 1984. Sri A. Nyanashekaran also completed degree in law and MBA in later years after clearing All India Civil Services Examination held in the year 1989. Sri A. Nyanashekaran joined the Indian P&T Accounts and Finance Service. In his long career spanning 26 years, Sri Nyanashekaran held very senior positions in various telecom circles of Tamil Nadu, offices of BSNL at Mumbai, CCA of Kerala Circle. Sri A. Nyanashekaran is presently Control of Communication Accounts for the Karnataka Circle. He is also the Chief Vigilance Officer of ITI Limited. We also have Mr. T.V. Tulsidas. Mr. T.V. Tulsidas has been the Compliance Officer and Company Secretary of Kenna Metal India Limited since February 13, 2017 and serves as the General Manager of Legal. Mr. Tulsidas has over 15 years of rich and varied experience in corporate secretarial, legal, ethics and compliance functions in Indian and multinational companies. He is also a qualified legal professional. Mr. Tulsidas is an associate member of the Institute of Company Secretaries of India. And we also have Mr. Arish H.V. from Grant Thornton, who is a Bachelor of Engineering, Mechanical, Postgraduate Diploma in Management in IIM Calcutta. His advanced management program, he has also advanced management program from Harvard Business School. Arish has nearly about 30 years experience in corporate finance, consulting, investment banking and industry. He is part of the leadership team of the firm and looks after growth markets and strategy. His focus areas of work is corporate finance, and he has built a strong corporate finance and advisory practice in Grant Thornton and advised several corporate and private equity firms in capital raising, M&A, valuation and related engagement. Arish has also worked in management consulting with AF Ferguson and Company, now member firm of Deloitte, industry as VP Corporate Affairs with Garware Polyester Limited, Manager Corporate Finance with Grosby Securities Limited, now SG Securities, and as Senior Account Manager Merchant Banking with HSBC Bank Mumbai, assisting several companies in capital raising, financial structuring. Let's welcome them all and let's take up the session.
Shikran, to highlight his thoughts.
Good evening to everyone. I start from the morning session where we heard from Sathya Kumar, Vigilance Commissioner. He has said something like Prevention of Corruption Act doesn't talk about money, it talks about gratification sense. It's true. I take it from there and move from my chairman, who stated the first sentence, like, yes, we are, the topic is transparency and efficiency in private sector, and its contribution to the same. But why public sector is required to hear on this? In fact, Chandramouli, previous speaker, in fact, has made a session bit atrociously, like, without the private sector participants here, he was addressing from private sector without any experience from the public sector. In my case, I have not had any experience from private sector. All along I have seen from government sector, plus now I am doing in private public. So let me restrict my discussion with reference to the transparency related issues. Any corporation, let it be small, is a conglomeration of like various stakeholders. You are aware, employees, customers, vendors, government, and society. Therefore, it is their responsibility to maintain fair and transparent to their own stakeholders. And all in their transactions, let me repeat, all in its transactions. If that be the case, the transparency should start in all level, then it should be known to all stakeholders involved in the company, right from employees to society. Managing any company depends on both the factors, internal as well as external, no doubt. The external factors, internal factors is inside and he will manage. External factors, naturally, the resource available, cost effectiveness of the resource. Then it is, then we have, last session we had a speaker was mentioning about the procurement time. It was not like 1 or 2 months, he was referring almost like 4 to 5 years, even more. By the time revision, at the end, where we are, we don't. So here, the corporate governance, because I am referring transparency with reference to corporate governance, or the corporate governance with commitment. What is the commitment? Commitment exactly to show what they are in the business, what they are doing it, explicitly inform to others, accordingly whether they are moving or not. If it is not moving as committed, then they are making mistake in the process. If they are making mistakes in the process, whether they will be held responsible individually or jointly. So these are all the issues comes under the transparency. It goes without saying, transparency is like ethical conduct of any organization. We can call it ethical sense, ethical conduct. The principles, principle is the same. In fact, the Cadbury report 1992 observes, the companies, how they are mentioned, because they are mentioning, the procedure by which companies are directed and controlled. If that be the case, whether the board of directors, whether independent director or director, functional directors, whether they are openly sharing the information, what is really required? Because the Cadbury report really discusses about the integrity of financial report. They say financial integrity is important. It should be given paramount importance. That's what they mentioned also. After that, there are committees. In fact, Naresh committee, Narayanamurthy committee. They have suggested, even Kumaramangala committee, because SEBI has constituted a committee under Kumaramangala Birla. That committee recommends. There are mandatory and non-mandatory provisions under almost like 49 issues. They have listed also, and they have not only listed the role of the directors in the company, what are their responsibility and accountability also. It goes like 7-8 items. It is also to be seen. The morning we were discussing about IT sector and the beauty sector. The first sector I will take. IT sector. In fact, Transparency International Global Report 2009, in which Infosys founder Narayanamurthy Garu has given his foreword, wherein he has said, growing a successful and sustainable business requires three issues at least, as mentioned. One, uncompromising devotion to the products and service that contribute to real value. Then cheerful, the leadership attracts and inspires manpower all over to join in the venture. Then the commitment, you said the commitment, because I have said in short, then it is there in the foreword, they have said a commitment. The commitment, not only that, our chairman was saying the seed capital of Tirupur entrepreneurs. In fact, Narayana Murthy said that in the foreword itself, the seed capital was little more than $250 when he founded Infosys. Then he has mentioned also in the foreword that what was expected from that company at that point of time itself and what exactly right now in the global scenario. Where is the status? All goes without saying the transparency and commitment, in fact, attached to the company, not only by the founder and the followers also. The transparency, when we talk about transparency, what exactly? It is like spontaneously we inform them, inform everyone, inform all the stakeholders. That's what he has mentioned much before, and it continues. Without taking much time, I will rest it from here. Then if any questions, I will answer from there by saying honesty and transparency make you vulnerable. Be honest and transparent anyway. This is the word given by Mother Teresa. Thank you this. Then I'll be waiting here for your questions. Thank you.
Now I request Sri T.V. Tulasidas, GM Legal and Company Secretary, Kenamedal India Limited. Thank you.
Thank you to all, to the moderator, and to all my learned friends on the panel, and to each one of you that each one of the august guests that are in attendance here. Now we've heard our moderator, Mr. Sathya Kumar, describe quite eloquently how the private sector, especially the MSME sector, contributes quite significantly to the growth of the Indian economy. And then thereafter, Mr. Nyanashekaran was describing most of the facets of corporate governance. He was tracing the origins of corporate governance. I come from a company which is an Indian subsidiary of a multinational. So what I will do is I will not dwell too much upon the origins of what the subjects my learned fellow panelists have spoken. I would rather want to touch upon the theme of winning with integrity. In fact, that's the mantra by which our company globally is guided. Some of you may have observed a news report a couple of days ago where it was reported that there were two Indian companies that made it to the list of most ethical companies globally published by an institution called, a respected independent institution called the Ethisphere Institute. And I believe there were only those two Indian companies, not Infosys, or it was actually Tata Steel and Wipro. And it's quite a significant achievement. I must first commend those companies for having made it there. The reason why I mention Ethisphere Institute is that we as a company have been ranked for 8 years consecutively now as one of the most respectable, most ethical corporations in the world. And there's a reason why I say that. It's a significant achievement when your peers, when independent, respected intellectuals and agencies like the Ethisphere Institute come validate your processes and then give you this recognition. The best case in this whole scenario is that the organizational ethos is what is what gets us these recognitions and what sustains our whole process. And this boils down to transparency. The whole theme of winning with integrity is that. And fortunately, in our case, and in the case of many other peers that we have seen, all of these corporations are either publicly listed, and therefore they have been abiding by the corporate governance requirements in, say, in the US, the SEC requirements, the Sarbanes-Oxley requirements, or in India, the SEBI listing regulations. And the good thing about all of these regulations is that the underlying theme of all that is transparency. And all of these regulations require corporations to constitute committees such as the audit committee, manned by independent directors, and to also report in real time. If you notice the simple provision where you are actually expected to report your results within 30 minutes. And one of the I can give you an inside perspective of what happens in those cases. The directors, especially the independent directors, are vigilant, and they keep asking questions. The flow of information to the directors and the supervisory, fiduciary role they exhibit in ensuring that the company is transparent and ethical is very high. It is actually indescribable as to the value, as to the kind of inputs that they share in making our corporations as transparent and as ethical as they are. And this is universal. Trust me, my friends, my interactions with many companies in India, which may be private, many subsidiaries, many Indian companies may not be listed as well, but this whole ethos has rubbed off on all of those companies. And today, the standards of transparency, the standards of integrity that are expected and that are pretty much becoming the common theme of our commercial discourse is fairly substantial. In fact, I'm encouraged to see more and more Indian companies, startups, and all of them have imbibed this culture. And therefore, what it does is that it keeps everyone on their toes. It to a large extent, rules out misdemeanors and any wrongdoing. And added to it, if we have robust internal audit systems as well in all of our corporations these days. And one of the central themes of internal audit is primarily this whole concept of whether policies are followed properly or whether the ethical standards are met. And in this context, I would think the whole theme of private sector contributing to the economy must be viewed, because if corporations ran their companies well and there's no wrongdoing there, I would think the economy would take care of itself very well. With these few words, I will turn the floor over to my next co-panelists and take leave. Thank you.
Thank you, Tulsi. Thank you for inviting me and for remaining audience who are still patiently waiting. I'm sure you're all looking forward to going home. We'll try to keep this as brief as possible. It's good to see that we're talking about transparency, governance, and we are all sitting in Bangalore, which, as was mentioned before, whenever you talk about good governance or transparency, we always think of companies like Infosys, which come from Bangalore, so we should all be proud of it. But you know, we are all reading the newspapers, we are all seeing what's happening in the larger society, and that should give us cause for concern. And I'm not going to talk about the specific topic of transparency in the private sector, but on the general concept of why do we need to talk about this topic itself. Why are we continuously coming out with potential so-called scams, loots, etc. But at the same time, nothing gets punished after 10, 15 years. I just saw a news item that the Bofors case will be heard again from some date soon. It's 35 years old. We still don't know whether there was corruption, who was the corrupt, where did the money go. Why can't we solve these problems? I don't know what is the issue. Is it that we don't want to punish people, or is it that we are making mountains out of molehills where none exist? But clearly, there is an issue with the way we have organized ourselves, the way we operate. And some time back, I had written a piece in Business Line where I said, how do we educate our children? Now, let's assume, and I'm equally guilty of what I'm saying, that if your child comes and says, Look, Daddy, I attend every class. I listen to everything. I submit all my things on time. And I think the typical comment most of us would make is, this guy is too diligent, this guy or this girl is too hardworking, and that is not going to be successful. And imagine another child who comes and says, look, Daddy, I just buttered up the teacher and I got more marks than I deserve. And we will praise that child, we will say this is the right way. Your child comes and says, I stood in the queue, it took 1 hour to get whatever form. And we'll say, look, you know, that's no way to succeed in India. In India, to succeed, you must know how to jump the queue. So this is what we train our children. And no wonder when they grow up as adults, we flout every rule. Forget people flouting larger rules. All of us flout traffic rules. All of us flout these rules. So something there in our upbringing that we need to change, and we need to change that. And that's when the larger questions of transparency and governance will be resolved. The second thing is, I think by nature, the government is suspicious of the private sector. They think that all private sectors are going to do something inappropriate, incorrect. Government is suspicious of all its employees. My apologies, but you know, we have officers like vigilance commissioners who are supposed to keep track. Why are we suspicious of everybody? We are suspicious of everybody we don't trust. As a society, we don't trust. We want more and more policing, more and more policing. Let's learn to trust. Definitely, there will be some people who will violate the trust. But you know, if we start trusting, I'm sure the trust will beget more trust rather than suspicion. When we deal with the government and they're thinking of a new policy or prescription to help grow the country, the first thinking in a bureaucrat's head is, if I do this, who is going to take advantage of this? How is he going to take advantage of this? So here is the benefit, but 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 rules to stop that. All of us are always thinking, you know, and I'm sure in the company also, if I'm going to give a leave policy, I will say, okay, leave policy is given, but to monitor that, we will want 5 signatures for this thing. When do we say that, you know, your expense statements, you know, all of us in companies travel, we want 2 approvals, 3 proofs. At some point, let's start blind trusting. I'm sure we will be violated, there will be crooks and criminals, but I am confident as a country and as a society, 99.9% of us are straightforward, honest people. I mean, there will be. Why make rules for the 0.1%, which is not going to change their behavior, but is going to impact all of us? So some thoughts for us to think. So maybe I have not talked about the topic that was given to me, but I just thought I'll share some of these larger questions that we need to ponder over before we get into specifics of governance transparency. Thank you very much for giving me the opportunity.
It gives us a message that the ethics, before even it starts with the private enterprise, these private enterprises are floated by the individuals who are groomed in the family, and the ethics and transparency should start in the family, from the school. And this also throws me to my own experience, which I wanted to share to the larger interest of the audience, which will be interest to you. I used to have a unique quality where I used to visit the tribal people to understand how they live. The Vivekananda Kendra runs about 74 schools in northeastern region, and they run about 9 schools in Andaman Nicobar. And there is a rare breed of tribals who the world is actually looking at protecting them, all those things. When I went there, and the particular person, Vivekananda Kendra, personally can interact with them. They don't allow anybody else. Unless they have acquaintance only, they allow. And when we are interacting, I found that we actually call them tribals and say they are backward. But from the perspective of ethics, values, they are far more better than the civilized society. I'll tell you, none of the houses have doors. And they don't know what is thief or theft. These words are not in their language itself, in the dialects. And second important thing, when the tsunami came, none of them got affected. These people went and sat in the mountain before 2 days, because they are so advanced in technology that they were able to judge from the birds' feathers, it seems, that the tsunami is going to come. These are the kind of people we have in India And ethics and values are not about the private sector. It's more to do with education. And coming back where Ajis and everybody has highlighted, our education system is so colonized. Still, we are not independent out of it. In 1947, we got the independence, but we never got out of this education system. I always ask the student, who fixed this 40 marks? We all aspire to get this 40 marks. We chartered accountancy, of course, in chartered accountancy, we have to get 50 in aggregate, for which we struggled many times. And then school examination. So we have somewhere moved to the marking system than the value system. And Indian society was always under the value system. Go and check Arthashastra. Today we talk about ease of doing business. World Bank comes out with ease of doing business. Kautilya's Arthashastra talks about a statement where it says to run an economic activity, you have to remove all the hindrances. That is ease of doing business. So these are the values which was there in Indian culture, which has to be revived back only through education and the value system. And this is the point which I want to share. And private sector or public sector, ethics and values are built in the education institutions and families. If they're okay, then everything is okay around. And I think India will reach to that level in the days to come. And from the key takeaways from, after that we'll have a question and session. The key takeaways from Gyaneshekaran sir was about the transparency in all transactions. In the name of transparency, again in GST, when he is highlighting, I immediately remember about the GSTR1, GSTR2, GSTR3. I was very surprised when the Indian government said that all the transactions has to be uploaded in the return filing. I was very skeptical at that point of time. How will India handle 36 billion invoices in the system? And my skepticism is right. Until now, the system is not operating. And in the name of transparency, we went on to create difficulty of doing business for the people who are just meager 20 lakhs turnover. We brought them and say, please register for GST. Why should they register? And why should we make them bring tough things? And I was surprised to know in the current month, the Nandan Nilekani spoke about reforming again the existing GST system. Can you imagine? We have already invested 1,400 crore in that infrastructure. And the question is, these are all the transparency. In the name of transparency, we cannot burden. Transparency should be brought as a self-governance. That one message which is very clear. It spoke about ethical content.
Here, the transparency, we can ensure through various methods. The government of India, like introduced Digital India, yes, program is there, e-governance is there, then e-procurement they made it, and the GSM, e-marketing they made it. In fact, that in addition to that, last year, in fact, July 2016, Government of India has fixed a target of 2,500 crore transaction for the years 2017 and 18, out of which almost 583 crore transaction fixed by the Department of Telecom to ensure digital transaction. So in the way of digital transaction, so naturally the other mode of payments and other things are controlled, then the transparency and efficiency comes on its own.
Right, please. That's absolutely right point. And he also highlighted about the transparency global.